I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Gaurav Gogoi, who runs a forum of youth and foreign policy. He's also a first-time MP from Assam, and he's going to be talking to us about food in diplomacy. Please. Thank you.
So, Advaita, thank you very much. Having me follow after Rocky and Mayur is an act in suicide because I'm a politician. And once you start speaking after Rocky and Mayur, you feel like, oh no, I should better just like start making some slogans in order to attract the same attention. But looking at those pictures of Rocky and Mayur, I thought like, either I've eaten a lot of food or I'm really hungry. So my mind feels as I've eaten a lot of food. I've had Bengali food, I've had Sri Lankan food, I've had Keralite food, I've had food from Assam, but my stomach is groaning and is complaining. So I won't take too long. Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to be here. I was a bit hesitant when Advaita and the organizers contacted me to speak at this event. This event is a major departure from the noisy and boisterous corridors of Parliament when the bulldoze tactics of the ruling and the vociferous slogans of the opposition are norm. Therefore, to speak on a subject of food and diplomacy and keep it as entertaining or even 10% of as entertaining as Rocky and Mayur is a bit challenging, so bear with me. Food in diplomacy, a strange topic, but a topic which is not stranger to a politician. We are part of intense negotiations, whether at domestic venues or at global venues. And often as we see as the negotiations go on and we get more hungry, we are willing to give more to the other party. We just want to get out of that negotiating room, get us out of here. So we see that food is in a very important aspect of cultural diplomacy or public diplomacy. Of course, when you go back to negotiation, you want to win the hearts and mind of your opponent. And what better way than food, which is a direct entry into its stomach. But history also teaches us that you better be careful when you're negotiating. Because the Greeks and Romans, when they were adversaries, used to make each other get drunk over wine so that they can spill secrets over where the military or where the army is based. So I'm glad this event talks about food and not about beverage because it opens another Pandora's box. Food being used as soft power. Now that has been highlighted even in our Hindu legends. It was said that the god of wealth, Kuber, wanted to impress the Lord Destroyer Shiva himself by inviting Shiva to a big grand feast. But this invitation was at the behest of Kuber's ego. And Shiva chose to send his son Ganesh as an emissary. And those of us who know our Hindu legends and gods, we know that Lord Ganesh has a voracious appetite. So as this dinner progressed, Kuber kept feeding Ganesh one meal after the other, tried to impress upon Ganesh that how wealthy he is, but Ganesh kept on eating. And at one point, the meals ran out and Ganesh started eating up parts of the Kuber's palace and decorations. Now Kuber got panicked. He was frightened. He had no idea. He runs to Lord Shiva and says that, I have fed him the cuisines from across the world and across the galaxies, and yet your son is not satisfied. What should I do? Shiva looks at him and just smiles and says, when you serve food to your friends and to those who've come to your home, and you serve food with an arrogance, they're never satisfied. You serve the simplest amount of food with love and humility, and a simple bowl of roasted rice would bring a smile to Ganesh's face. And that's what Kuber did. He went back, offered a bowl of roasted rice to Ganesh, and Ganesh walked away happy. So food is an excellent way of communicating. Food can bring people together when times are tough. United States and Cuba never had diplomatic relations, but Cuban food could be found in United States even before the thaw happened with Obama and Raul Castro. US-Vietnamese diplomatic relationships were off the charts, and they were never strong allies because the Vietnam was supposed to be seen as an ally of Russia. But Vietnamese food was found in America, and that helped societies know about Vietnamese culture because food is a great way about communicating about our culture and about our values. Now coming back to our neighborhood as well, India and Pakistan, our two politicians, we start fighting over each other. But the minute the fighting gets done, we go and we start enjoying and talk about our common love for kebabs. And our love for kebabs can even outweigh our love for cricket. But still, I might say and I might add, if you want to start a war between India and Pakistani diplomat, just ask him which country serves the better kebab. And that's it. Finish. Well, governments across the world have been quick to use their local cuisines as an ambassador of their culture and values. When Prime Minister Modi recently hosted top CEOs in New York, In order to market brand India, it was important to make a right impression. And what did he do? He flew Chief Vikas Khanna, and the brilliant chef made a 7-course fusion menu, which included paneer ravioli. Now let's start getting more hungry. Manipuri black rice, which is a fantastic, if you have not tried it, I suggest you try Manipuri black rice. Coconut rice creme brulee, for those of us who are health nerds and health geeks, want to try coconut rice creme brulee. Thandai chicken, pomegranate sangria with tandoori pineapple, coconut chutney, molten cake with berry compote and sevian cakes. Now, I'm sure after eating such a menu, the government of India was able to curry a lot of favors from the US government. But, that's the beauty of Indian food. Our food has migrated across boundaries. It does not recognize the boundaries of sea, the boundaries of mountains, and the boundaries that we have in our minds. Indian cuisine in the Middle East have been influenced greatly by the large Indian diaspora. Centuries of trade relations and cultural exchanges have resulted in significant influence on each other's regions' cuisine, the most notable being the biryani. It was introduced by the Persian invaders into northern India and has become an integral part of the Mughlai cuisine. Indian cuisine is extremely popular in Southeast Asia as well. I'm from Assam. I remember going on a presidential visit to Bhutan, which is not in Southeast Asia, but still is an example. We went on an official delegation to Bhutan, and I had colleagues of mine who were from North India, and they went to Bhutan and we served this big grand menu by the Bhutanese embassy. And for many of them, they had to bridge, because their appetites and their palates were not used to having something from Bhutan. Whereas me, from being a neighboring state such as Assam, which is, we share a border with Bhutan. For me, it was like, wow, this is some of the best food I've ever had, because the cuisines share so much of similarity. It's the same between Assamese and Naga cuisine with cuisine that you might find in Thailand and Vietnam. We use a lot of local greens. We use a lot of pork meats. And we use a lot of rice-made wine, which, if you're in the field of politics, you must have if you want to win your tribal vote. Bamboo shoots with pork and Ahomya, Bhut Jolokia and Dhekia are prime examples of flavors that are from Northeast India. And I know Rocky has a fascination for Northeast Indian food, but he didn't mention where you can find Assamese food in Delhi, and that's when you go to Assam Bhavan and go to the basement restaurant called Jakoi, and you'll have a fantastic food, and you'll see that all of Delhi media is sitting there just eating Northeastern food. So if you want to go, there's another plug for Assamese food in Delhi. I'm a big fan of Rajdhani, and I'm a big fan of Bohemia. And I think Jakoi, the vegetarian thali, Mayur will appreciate this. The vegetarian thali in Jakoi is one of the best vegetarian thalis that you'll find in Delhi.
Agreed.
The parampara vegetarian thali.
We've eaten a few times.
Okay, good. So Rocky and Mayur have endorsed it. Now, do I need to say anything more, right? Is that in your book?
Yes. The Paradise Guwahati one.
Okay.
Same ownership.
Yes, it is. Good. Otherwise, our friendship. But no dish. Many dishes of India have traveled across the world, but no dish has achieved the legendary status of the chicken tikka masala. Now, this can start another diplomatic war between India and the UK. That who is the original inventor of the chicken tikka masala, because it's called a true British national dish. In 2003, there were as many as 10,000 restaurants serving Indian cuisine in England and Wales alone. According to Britain's Food Standards Agency, the Indian food industry in the United Kingdom is worth £3.2 billion. Now, if Shashi Tharoor wants to make another speech about what the UK owes to India, he can talk about that they've got a $3.2 billion food industry thanks to India. Another thing which I might want to add, another thing that the British owe to India is the discovery of tea. Now, this event is about food, but beverage plays an important part. Tea was originally manufactured in China, and Chinese tea had a monopoly over the world. The British, because they were the original imperialists before the Americans, wanted to break this monopoly of Chinese tea. So they sent people as explorers to Northeast India, and one explorer by the name of Robert Bruce, fell sick and was recovering in a tribal chieftain's place. As he was recovering from basically the tropical diseases and symptoms that you find in a place which has a lot of humidity and rain, as he was recovering, he noticed that the tribal chieftain was feeding him a concoction of boiling water mixed with a little bit of leaves, and he recovered from that. He sent the leaves back to UK, and the laboratory in the UK saw that these tea leaves had the same property as Chinese tea. And voila, the British finally found a way of breaking the monopoly of Chinese tea. They went into India, made Assam tea, initially got people from China to work in Assam and, you know, and make Chinese tea, but soon the Chinese realized that India is not China, and they went back home. And finally, the British evolved a way of tea, which is an Assam tea, which is different from Chinese tea. And you know what? One of the biggest contributors, and Shashi Tharoor can mention this in his speech as well, he's speaking here tomorrow, one of the biggest contributors to the British economy during the colonial administration was the tea produced from Northeast India. They were able to break the Chinese monopoly and basically continue their hegemony. But coming back to India, and I agree with what Rocky and Mayu says. I mean, India is an ocean of people, of cultures, of food. We've had food influences from Persia, from China, from Mongolia, from Central Asia, from so many places. And this is something which is truly uniquely Indian, that we're able to assimilate all these influences and then grow them and nurture them into something that is uniquely Indian. They might have originated somewhere else, but once they come in and they integrate and immerse themselves in this volume of, you know, food-loving nation that we call India, that we develop and evolve a cuisine which is absolutely spectacular, mind-boggling, and Rocky and Mayur are doing the right thing, which is that we should make South Asian cuisine the next big ambassador after Chinese or the French. I'm trying to figure out a joke with Ubiquitous, but I can't, but at least I'm trying. But anyways, our cuisine will not have survived, and this is something that, you know, Rocky and Mayu said with humor, but I'm saying with a lot of seriousness. Our cuisine, our Indian cuisine, will not have survived if we preached hatred or bigotry. It only survived because we had a feeling of celebration, we had a feeling of appreciation, we had a feeling of respect. And if we want this culture and this values base to continue, then as my predecessor said, that we must eat everything. I only hope that this event reminds us of our unique gift and enables us to be proud of our values and ethics, and enables us to be proud of who we are. We are Indians, and we are proud of what we eat. Thank you very much.
More questions, Paul? You're not taking
any questions?
That's autocratic.
I'm just, you know, I don't want black ink thrown on me.
What is your favorite food from Assam?
My favorite food, I mean, okay, the first line, I mean, when people ask me what is Assamese food, it's a difficult question to answer. Because like Gujarat, which has like 22,000 recipes, so does Assam. So in my head, Assamese food is broadly categorized in three categories. One is Mughlai cuisine, or similar to Mughlai, which is because of the Mughal influence. The second is the Mongoloid tribal food, which is about tea made roasted in bamboo. About chicken roasted in bamboo. That's excellent. You know, that's something that I really like. And of course, the traditional Assamese food, which is, you can say, simpler, which is similar to Bengali food about rice, dal, and fish, but, you know, with less spices. The main thing that I enjoy after hard days of work is just eating rice, dal, and something that we make called khar, which is a paste. So that's, you know, I'm happy when you just feed me that. Thank you very much. Any other questions?
One quick one. When we discussed this earlier, you spoke of tribal food from Assam and how you were looking at promoting that across the country. You know, what are your plans for it, and what do you think is the future, even after listening to Rocky and Mayur, where it's fully endorsed regional cuisine, finding a place, you know, in mainstream restaurants. But this is also sub-regional in a sense, right? It's the next level.
Well, it's a good question. Again, and I find it as a linkage with international diplomacy and foreign policy, right? Because we're talking about Act East and Look East, and we're talking about how India should get closely integrated with its with countries such as Thailand, Vietnam, Myanmar, Singapore. And what better way to show that we share something unique than to share our food cuisines? So in my head that, you know, if we can get the Southeast Asian embassies that are in Delhi and do a Southeast Asian food festival, which not only takes Southeast Asian flavors, but also Northeast flavors, then we're able to kind of, you know, share the commonalities that exist in our societies, and the ways that we cook are so similar. So it's a great way of sharing. Another good thing which is happening in Assam is that tea initially used to be done by big plantations. You had the Tatas, you had the, you know, MacLeod Russell. So they had these big tea plantations. But now a new thing which is starting is that their small farmers are, instead of cultivating vegetables, are cultivating tea. So you have a lot of boutique teas which are coming up. You have like herbal tea, you have green tea, you have green tea with some flavors, you have like a medicinal tea. So a lot of small tea growers are coming up. We hope to like encourage that. The very same way you have small wine growers from Napa Valley doing their own boutique wines, we can have a lot of boutique teas which are emerging from Assam, and that's something that we hope to do more as well. Thanks.
There's a lot of ignorance about the cuisine of the seven states. In fact, we had a discussion online and somebody mentioned Northeast cuisine, and somebody from Nagaland got very offended that how can you say Northeast cuisine rather than the rest thing. So, but
it's like saying South Asian cuisine is Indian cuisine. You know what happens to Nepal,
Indian,
or Sri Lanka,
is not
Pakistan.
Indian because a lot of there are a lot of regions for India also. So how do you plan to go about educating people through food? There are a lot of places now which have opened up in Delhi which are doing different cuisines from different states.
Mm-hmm.
And I mentioned that this is. But how effective is it that is it happening? And people are still very, because people still think that a bamboo shoot and a pork dish is Northeast. It's a dish of all the seven states.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you plan as a politician or probably a food lover to tackle something like that?
Well, first of all, it's a good question. Thanks very much. First of all, the first thing I do is invite people to visit Assam and Northeast. So therefore, you will see Assam tourism is also part of this food event. We want people to travel to the region because that's the best way of breaking barriers and any misconceptions or breaking any misunderstandings that you might have about the region. The second thing, we do what, you know, Prime Minister Modi does, that any major event that is taking place. For example, we had an international car rally, an ASEAN car rally, where the rally driver started their point from Jakarta and ended in Guwahati. And throughout the journey, as they entered into Assam, all that we were feeding them was local cuisine. So we are integrating our food in every event that we do in Assam. Even if I organize a conference and I get a lot of speakers, both from a, you know, from a global community or from a national community, we tell them that, you know, we serve Assamese cuisine and traditional Assamese cuisine. Secondly, I'm a big brand ambassador of Jokoi. I keep telling people to go about Jokoi. Thirdly, we're trying to figure out ways, and maybe, you know, this is something that we can learn from, you know, interested people here and personalities and trade bodies and associations as to how to get at least certain items, even if not the cuisine, but certain items to be ubiquitous, such as Manipuri black rice or bhut jalokia. So we need trying to figure out a lot of ways. Food is a, if you look at any economist report about Northeast, you know, whether it's KPMG, PwC, they talk about creating economic growth in Northeast India. They say that just look at your natural resources, and that's food. The organic content within your tea, your cumin, your coriander, your ginger is some of the highest in terms of organic requirements. So if you want to export organic commodities from India, then you have to look at the Northeast as an organic hub. And you know, states like Sikkim have already declared themselves as an organic state. So we're looking at the entire food industry and ecosystem as a way of promoting the region. Thanks.
Well, enough with this. Are the Northeast chili the hottest in
the world? The Northeast chili naturally is the hottest chili. There's a Mexican chili which is taken number one, but that's a hybrid. So, I mean, that's cheating. So that's like having Monty Panesar, you know, throwing spin balls in UK tea. So that's not fair. But if you look at original, then yes, the bhut jalokia, the Northeast chili, the Naga chili is the hottest chili in the world. It has fantastic flavor and a fantastic aroma. I would definitely advise you to try it, but only with a little thing. Thanks. Any last questions before we break for lunch? I think it's been great to hear everyone, and I would like to congratulate the organizers. It's a fantastic you know, way of bringing hearts and minds and certainly stomachs together. Thank you for inviting me. I don't get the opportunity to speak much in Parliament because we're always shouting. So any opportunity to speak is something that we, you know, run for as politicians. Thank you very much.